a very pleasant day to all of you. So dear students, today we are going to start the next chapter, Tazima by Mary Russell Mitford. In this we are going to read out a very interesting story. Once upon a time, a certain Ron in Tazima Suma, by name an able and well-read man, being on his travels to see the world, went up to Kyoto by Tokaido, the road of Eastern. See, the famous high road leading from Kyoto to Edo, the name is also used to indicate the provenances through which it runs. One day in the neighborhood of Nagoya, in the province of Awaseki, he fell in with a wandering priest with whom he entered into conversation, finding out that they were bound for the same place. They agreed to travel together, beguiling their weary way by pleasant talk on diverse matters. And so by degrees, as they became more intimate, they began to speak without restraint about their private affairs. And the priest, trusting thoroughly in the honor of his companion, told him the object of his journey. "For some time past," said he, "I have nourished a wish that is engrossed all my thoughts, for I am bent on setting up a molten image in honor of Buddha. With this object, I have wandered through various provinces collecting alms, and who knows by what weary toil we have succeeded in amassing 200 ounces of silver, enough, I trust, to erect a handsome bronze figure. But what says the proverb? He who bears a jewel in his bosom bears poison hardly." Had the Ronin heard all these words of the priest, then an evil heart arose within him, and he thought to himself, "Man's life, from the womb to the grave, is made up of good and ill luck. Here I am, I nearly 40 years old, a wanderer, without a calling or even without a hope of advancement in this world. To be sure, it seems a shame. Yet if I could steal the money this priest is boasting about, I could live at ease for the rest of my life." And he was very greedy at that point, so he began casting about how best he might compass his purpose. But the priest's art, from guessing the drift of his comrades' thoughts, journeyed cheerfully on till they reached the town of Kawana. And here there is an arm of the sea which is crossed in ferry boats that starts as soon as some 20 or 30 passengers are gathered together, and in one of these boats the two travelers embarked about halfway across the priest. Priest was taken with a sudden necessity to go to the side of the boat, and Ronin, following him, tripped him up while no one was looking, and flung him into the sea water. When the boatman and the passengers heard the splash and they saw the priest struggling in the water, they were afraid and made every effort to save him. But the wind was fair and the boat was turning swiftly under the belly in sails, so they were soon a few hundred yards off from the drowning man, who sank before the boat and could be turned to rescue him. Means no chances of his saving was there. When he saw this, the Ronin feigned the utmost grief and his mane, and said to his fellow passengers, "This priest whom we have just lost was my cousin. And he was going to Kyoto to visit the shrine of his patron. As I happened to have business there as well, we settled to travel together now. Alas, by this misfortune, my cousin is dead now and I am left alone. So he wanted to grab the wealth of the priest. He spoke so feelingly and wept so freely that the passengers believed his story and pitied, and they tried to comfort him. Then the Ronin said to the boatman, "We ought by rights to report this matter to the authorities, but as I am pressed for time and the business might bring trouble on yourself as well, perhaps we had better hush it up for the present, and I will at once go on to Kyoto and tell my cousin's patron beside writing home about it. What think you, gentlemen?" added he, turning to the other travellers. And they all, of course, were only too glad to avoid any hindrance to their onward journey. And so that's why, with one voice, agreed to what the Ronin had proposed. And so the matter was settled down. When at length they reached the shore, they left the boat and every man went his way. But Ronin overjoyed in his heart. Why he was overjoyed? Due to the wealth. He took the wandering priest's luggage and putting it with his own, pursued his journey to Kyoto. On reaching the capital, the Ronin changed his name from Jumi to Takobe, and giving him his position as a samurai turned merchant and traded with the dead man's money fortune favoring his speculations. He began to amass great wealth and lived at his ease, denying himself nothing. Ending course of time, he married a wife who bore him a child. Thus the days and months were moved on, and one fine summer's night, some 3 years after the priest's death, Takobe stepped out on the veranda of his house to enjoy the cool air and the beauty of the moonlight. He was feeling dull and lonely. He began musing over all kinds of things when on a sudden the deed of murder and theft done so long ago vividly recurred to his memory, and he thought to himself, "Here am I grown rich and fat on the money I want only stole since." Then the man was drowned in the sea water. "And all has gone well with me yet. Had I not been poor, I had never turned assassin or thief. Oh, who betide me? What a pity it was." And he was just having a sense of repentance. He was revolving the matter in his mind. A feeling of remorse came over him. In spite of all he could do, while his conscience thus smote him, he suddenly, to his utter amazement, beheld the faint outline of a man standing near a far tree in the garden. And he was looking on more attentively, he perceived the man's whole body was thin, and worn out clothes were also there, and his eyes were sunken and dim. And who it was? The poor man, the poor ghost that was before him, he recognized that it was the very priest whom he had thrown into the sea at Kona, chilled with horror. He looked again and saw that the priest was smiling and scorned, and he would have fled into the house. But the ghost stretched forth with its withered arm and clutching the back of his neck, scolded at him.
with a vindictive glare and a hideous ghastliness of mien so unspeakably awful that any ordinary man would have swooned with fear at Okabe tradesman, though he had once been a soldier and was not easily matched for daring. So he shook off the ghost and leaping into the room for his dirk laid about his boldly and up. But strikes as he would the spirit fading into the air, and it eluded his blows and suddenly reappeared, only to vanish again. And from that time forth, who knew no rest and was haunted night. And he was thinking that it was the ghost of the priest. And day at length, undone by such ceaseless vexation, Tukumai fell ill and kept muttering, "Oh, misery, misery, the wandering priest is coming back, coming to torture me. He came back and he wanted to torture me." Hearing his moans and disturbance, he made the people in the house fancy that he was mad and called a physician, who prescribed for him, but neither pill nor potion could cure Tokyo. Tokyo was a strange transition and became the talk of the whole neighborhood. And now, chance that the story reached the ears of a certain wandering priest who lodged in the next street. When he heard the particulars, this priest gravely shook his head as though he knew all about it, and he sent a friend to Tokyo, Obe's house, to say that a wanderer increased dwelling hard by the hurt of his illness, and were it never so grievous, would undertake to heal it by means of prayers. And he took away his wife, driven half wild by her husband's sickness lost. Not a moment of sending for the priest and taking him to the sick man's room. But what happened at the time? No sooner did took a basi the priest than he yelled out, "Help, help, there is wandering priest come to torment me again. Forgive, forgive, forgive." He just asking for the forgiveness, as he has made the priest to drown into the sea. Hiding his head under the coverlet, he acquiring all over, then the priest turned all present out the room, put his mouth to the affrighted man's ear and whispered, "3 years ago at the Kona ferry, you flung me into the water, and well, you remember it." But Tokyo Bay was speechless and could only quack, was shivering due to the fever. "Fear, happily I had learned to swim and to dive as a boy, so I reached the shore, and after that, wandering through many provinces, succeeded in setting up a bronze figure to Buddha, thus fulfilling the wish of my heart on my journey. Then I returned homeward. I took a lodging in the next street and there heard of your marvelous ailment. Thinking I could divine its cause, I came to see you, and I am glad to find that I was not mistaken you. You have done a hateful deed, but I am not oppressed. I have not forsaken for the things of this world, and would it become me to bear the malice? Repent, therefore, abandon your evil ways to the void. And you do so, I should esteem the height of happiness to happiness of good cheer now, and look me in the face, and you will see that I am really a living man. I am not a ghost. I am no vengeful.
Robin come to torment. You seeing, he had no ghost to deal with and overwhelmed the priest's kindness. And at last he burst into tears and answered, "Indeed, indeed, I don't know what to say in a fit of madness. I was tempted to kill and to rob you. And fortune befriended us again." So this is the story up to here.